right? Praise God. Well, listen here, Abe, we're so glad that you all are here with us on this morning. I'm grateful that the Lord has smiled on us. I'm not going to be this morning's speaker, amen, but we do have someone that's going to minister the Word of God. And praise the Lord. I want you to prepare yourself to receive her as she comes, amen. With Minister Jones, come on up, praise the Lord. Go ahead on and let's point your hand towards Minister Jones. And Minister Jones, this is the day that the Lord has made. We do believe that God has given you a word for us. Minister it with power, with intent, and with purpose. Amen. Give God a hand of praise for Minister Jones.
Amen. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. You may have your seats. Thank you. It is with great pleasure and honor that I come before you this morning. And before I begin, I would just like to give a word of prayer, praising God and thanking Him for this opportunity to be able to minister to His people. Amen. You may close your eyes. Heavenly Father, we thank you today. We thank you for this opportunity, oh Father God. We thank you that you have called us out among the call outs to minister to your people. Thank you, oh Father God, for a word for your people today, that their lives might be enriched and blessed more. May it settle in their hearts and in their minds that they might not sin against thee. Father God, use me, hold me up with your righteous right hand. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Amen. Thank God for this opportunity. Thank you, Bishop. And thank you for all of you that are assembled here together this morning. That early this morning when that shower came down, I know you wanted to stay in the bed, but you got up anyway. I know you wanted to do that. It was good to turn over and get another little snooze, wasn't it? Amen. We're going to go ahead and get on into the Word of God because that's the purpose that we're here for, is to hear from God. And this morning, I'm going to be reading for your hearing from the book of Ephesians in the New Testament. We're going to be looking at what Paul, one of the greatest writers of most of the New Testament and one of the tallest oaks in the Bible. Paul was stopped on Damascus Road during a time that he did not even know the Lord. And he was stricken down and blinded. And he didn't understand what was going on, but he had been called out to do a work for God. And thank God for Paul. Thank God for Paul and his writings that he gives to us. And this morning, we're going to be looking at Ephesians, the 6th chapter. And I'm going to be reading in your hearing verses 10 through 18. If you don't mind, please stand for the reading and the hearing of God's holy word. Ephesians, the 6th chapter, and I will be reading from the King James Version. And it says, "Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore," now he gives you one, he tells you what to do. "Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. Stand therefore," now he's telling you something else to do. "Stand therefore, having your loins girded about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith you shall be able to quench the fiery darts of the wicked one. And take the helmet of salvation on, and the sword of the Spirit, the word of God. Praying," don't leave out prayer, "praying always." He didn't say sometimes, but he said when? all prayer and supplication in the spirit, watching unto though with all perseverance and supplication. And may God add a blessing to the reading and the hearing of his holy word. You know, it's not common that for us to understand that we are in a warfare. Right now, we know that the nation of Russia and Ukraine are in a physical war. But there's a war going on daily, a war that we can't see. And that's called a spiritual war. And a spiritual war is one that you don't know when it's attacking unless you understand what the members of your body are designed for. And sometimes we just do not adhere or pay attention to the things that are going on in our spirit, in our spirit man, in our mental mind, in our body about what is going on in this world. Satan never stops attacking. He's always lurking, seeking, and trying to find out whom he might devour. First of all, he tries to tear your body up. I don't know about y'all, but woo! And then age is not any help, because the older you get, seems like the more he tries to attack. But that's not the war that we need to be concerned about, because it's already told us that we're not here to live forever in this body, that the dust that we came from is going to go back to the dust of the earth. But there is a place that the spirit of man, that inner person, has to return to. And that's the one that Satan is raging war on. That's the one he wants to get all confused and not know what to do when it comes to the things of God. And as the writer of our lesson this morning is the Apostle Paul. And Paul tells us that he writes he's in prison right now. And he's writing a letter. He's writing a letter to the Ephesians telling them to put on the whole armor of God. He's telling us to be booted and suited in the things of God. You know, I have on some things that looks like what someone in the army might wear. Is that right? But that's not what he's attacking. He's not attacking his outward appearance. He's attacking the inward man. Paul wrote to the Ephesians to instruct them and others in the good news of the salvation he wanted to build and awareness of being connected to each other and the church. See, Satan wants us to be divided. He wants us to be separated from one another. And that's what the enemy does. And he says that he also taught the principles of living a spirit-filled life and waging spiritual warfare against the enemy, the devil. See, we worry about the outward appearance too much. We want to dress it up. We want to suit it up. We want to boot it up. And we want it to look good. It's nothing wrong with that. Don't get me wrong. We're supposed to take care of our body because that's where God's spirit lives. But the most important thing is for us to protect the spirit of God. And that's why Paul is telling us to put on the whole armor of God. This scripture is an analogy to what the outward armor looks like compared to what the spiritual person needs on the inside. You know, we're good about protecting the flesh armor. When it's raining, we're going to put on a raincoat or we're going to get an umbrella. But we're not as cautious about protecting the spiritual man. We'll look at anything. We'll listen to anything. We'll go any place. And we'll do anything. So we got to be careful in what and we'll take anything into the eye gates of our soul, which are our eyes. We look at the wrong movies. We read the wrong books. In other words, we practice the wrong thing. I'm guilty. I hope I'm not the only one here that's guilty. We're all guilty of doing things that are ungodly, that are not pleasing in God's eyesight. His letter to them also reminds them that they are universal, connected to other Christians like them and ourselves, who are in moral combat with a common enemy, Satan. It is virtually important that we stay in close fellowship with other Christians so so that we can be encouraged and gain spiritual strength to resist the devil who goes around like a roaring lion for someone to eat. Now, he wants to eat us up. You know, he doesn't play fair. He paints a pretty picture, but in turn, he's dividing you all the time. Alone, we are weak, vulnerable to him. Together, we still have full victory through God who showed us his love. Many Ephesians during this time, and I'm coming from the book of Ephesians, and many Ephesians in Ephesus had a background of religious gods and spirits that were not the true and living God. They worshipped idol gods. They did things that were ungodly. So therefore, Paul is writing, telling them to put on the whole armor of God. Put on your suit, put on your boots, and be rooted in the things of God. In order to be fully under, in order to fully understand putting on the whole armor of God, we must know and understand the church and the spiritual blessings we have in Christ. You know, we've been adopted to sonship, forgiven and redeemed. We have been raised and seated with Christ in heaven, which comes by the grace that we receive by faith. You know, God doesn't force himself on us. He gives us a choice. And if I were you today, I'd make that choice to be a part of God's army. You know, that through the gospel, Gentiles are heirs together with Israel, members of the body and partakers in the promise of Christ Jesus. Therefore, Paul reminds them. He reminds them to live a life worthy of the calling we have received in Christ Jesus. He's doing the same thing today for us. He's continuously calling us to come to him. We are called to a unity as a body of believers through one Lord, one Spirit, and one hope. We are to be imitators of God and live a life of love because Christ gave himself up for us as a sacrifice to God. God went out on Calvary's cross. He gave up the ghost. He was buried in a borrowed tomb. But on the third day, he rose that you and I might have life. Let Christ rise in your life. You know, we got to, as a consequence, in order to let God rise in our life, we have to put away all of these things that keeps us from coming to God. We have to get our mindset right. You know, the enemy loves to attack the mind. And see, the mind is where we serve, is what we serve God with. You know, we talk about the heart, but this is a piece of flesh that pumps on the inside. He's talking about the heart of the spirit that he blew into that clay back in the Garden of Eden. That's what he's talking about. He wants us to become heirs of the throne. He wants us to put away sexual immorality. He wants us to put away impurity. He wants us to put away greed and foolish talk, as it is improper for God's holy people. We are called to live as children of light in a dark world and to find out what pleases the Lord. We are to make every effort and opportunity to understand the Lord's will and be filled with his spirit. He left a roadmap for us. He left the Holy Bible for us to use to do what he called us out to do. All we have to do is take some time, read, study, pray, inquire, think about what he asked us to do, live in what he asked us to do. I'm not going to tell you it's easy. I'm not going to tell you that we're going to do everything right. But do take the time and do some of the things that God has called us out to do. We must give thanks to God to God in all things and submit to one another out of reverence to Christ. Let's learn to treat each other right. See, Satan loves it when we're in discord. He likes to mess us up. He wants me to not get along with everyone. He wants us to despise one another. He wants us to inject us with jealousy, with hate, with strife, with envy. That's his game. He knows when he does that, he got you messed up. He got you messed up and tore up from the floor up. get your mind right. You don't know which way to turn. That's his game. Look like by now, over 2,000 years up to 2022, we ought to recognize that booger. We ought to know his tactics by now. Come on, let's get it together. In Ephesians 6, Paul gives instructions to the children. Not only to the children, he gives instructions to the parents. He gives instructions to the slaves and the masters on how to relate well with others in whatsoever position we are in. This is what he does. He tells children to obey their parents. Colossians 3:20 says, children, obey your parents in everything because it pleases the Lord. Children, you have a part in this too. You're not too young to understand that Satan is like a roaring lion going out to devour you. I teach school, and I see him roaring in the children every day, all day long. He's roaring because they talk back. He's roaring because they don't follow rules. He's roaring because they don't know how to treat one another. He's continuously roaring. That's what he wants to do. He wants to roar in your life so that you can't hear what God is telling you in your spirit. He loves to block the ears, and he loves to block the eye gates so that you can't see and you can't hear what thus says the Lord. It says that he tells the fathers not to make their children angry, but to train them. Parents, we have a job to do. He didn't tell the television to train them. He didn't tell the radio to train them. He didn't tell the computer to train them. He didn't tell the iPads to train them. He didn't tell the cell phones to train them. He told you to train them. That's your job. You're a steward. He called us out to be stewards. And his children are his stewards. And he called you out to train them in the ways of him. Stop letting your children have their way. Who cares if they get upset? Who cares if they get mad? They're not paying any bills. They don't own anything. The only thing they are supposed to do is to obey what you tell them to do. Stop sparing the rod. In the Bible it says, beat the foolishness out of them. We're not going to beat them. We're scared to talk to them. We're scared to tell them to sit down and be quiet. We're afraid to tell our children that. He even told the fathers that don't provoke them, lest they become discouraged. We are to encourage our children. Sit your child down and talk to them. Tell them what God expects of them. Not only tell them, but live that before them. Let them see what God expects in you. He also talks to the slaves. He tells the slaves to obey their masters, and the masters to be good to the slave. He don't want us abusing one another. And he tells us all to be strong in the Lord by putting on the whole armor of God. Ephesians reminds us of our ultimate hope. But for some in this world, in this time that we're living in, their hope is in the COVID-19 vaccine. Not worrying about God works through medicines and everything that he allows man to do. For some, his hope is in a political reform. In some, his hope is in abortion laws. For some, his hope is to have your way in your own lifestyle. In some, his hope is in their bank account. In some, the hope is in their friend. All of these things that I've just listed causes you not to put on the full armor of God. That's what it does. But the Bible consistently reads that our hope is in who? Christ Jesus. In Christ Jesus. We put our hope in everything but Jesus. Because we think that we are tough enough, we're big enough, we're great enough, we're smart enough to do it our way. Let me serve you notice. Don't get upset with me. This is not Burger King. You can't have it your way. You can't hold the pickles, hold the lettuce, hold the mayo in Christ's army. You got to put it all on. You got to put on the full armor of God. The list goes on and on about the things that we want to be in control of. But the Bible continues tells us that our hope is in Christ Jesus. In Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 through 17, Paul warns us about the schemes. That means the tricks and the devices the enemy uses to destroy our life. Y'all know some of them schemes. Don't act like you don't know what they are. He done tried to use them on you and using them on some of us right now. The enemy uses these schemes to destroy our lives. Paul tells us in verse 10, what does it say? What does verse 10 say? To be what? To be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. And he tells you how to be strong. He tells you to put on his armor, to put on the whole armor of God. He tells us that we do not wrestle against flesh and blood. You know, we like to fight. We like to get each other. I watch the children at school. Every time you see them, they want to fight. What? Baby, why you fight? He hit me. He took my pencil. He won't leave me alone. We're always wanting to fight. But you know, if we put the armor on that God has called us out to put on, we wouldn't be no match for Satan. We'd tear him up. And we send him back to the pits of heaven once he came. That's what we're supposed to be doing. So if he tells us that we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, why are we shooting and killing, stealing and dealing, lying and laughing, stabbing and gabbing, all that Satan has, and grabbing all that Satan has to give to us? Need I remind you, Paul pleads that we do what? Put on the whole armor of God by girding up our minds and our tongues with the truth. Stop lying to yourself. Then you won't have to spread those lies to others. Get your mind on Christ and stay in perfect peace. Good God, we're in a war. Don't you realize we're in a war? Ukraine and Russia are in a physical war, but we are in a war too. We're in a spiritual war. Paul tells us we are not wrestling against what? Flesh and blood. So why are we continuously embracing the tricks and the schemes of Satan? We should know by now that we're in a spiritual warfare. So get suited up. Get suited and booted. Put on the whole armor of God. We need God. I don't know about you, but I can't make one day without him. I can't do anything without him. He's my orchestrator. He's my keeper. He's everything that I need. He's my all in all. He's my bread when I'm hungry. He's my water when I'm thirsty. He's the air that I breathe. He's the tree that I sit up under. He's the car that I drive. He's everything to me. I don't know about you, but I can't do without him. And I'm going to tell you something else. I'm not going to do without him. I'm going to bow down to the mighty power of God under his righteous right hand. There's no other way to live. I don't know why you call this mess that we do in life. Because it's not life. Without God, we have no life. We messed up, tore up from the floor. Get this right. Get your mind on Christ. Let him live within you. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise his name. Let me be transparent here for a minute. I've experienced a lot of things in life. I've done some things that I'm ashamed of. I've done some things I wouldn't dare tell anyone. I've thought some things that are ungodly. But I do thank God that he stopped me on a Damascus road just like he did Paul. He knocked me down. He had me crawling through my house, denying the fact that I wasn't going to serve Satan anymore. That I was going to come up fully to him, putting on the whole armor of God. I don't know about you. I don't know what you're going to do, but I'm going to stay booted and suited in the things of Christ. Let me tell you what it means to be booted and suited. How to put on the breastplate of righteousness. What is so hard about doing what's right? Somebody help me out. Somebody tell me. Help me figure out what's so wrong, what's so hard about doing right. It's not hard. It's just that we don't want to do it. That's all it is. We don't want to succumb. We don't want to bow down to God. I just told you we want to have it our way. You know, let's be honest and fair to one another. Let's be honest and put on the helmet of salvation by believing that Christ died for you. He died for me, and he rose again. Let's be honest, and let's keep the shield of faith. Know that God will keep his promises in our life. Faith in God will protect us when we are tempted to doubt. We've doubted God. Don't fool yourself, we've doubted. Let us put on the belt of truth, because it keeps us from giving into the world's belief. Compare your beliefs and actions to the truth of God's word. There's no comparison. There's no comparison. Feel prepared with the gospel of peace. The gospel of peace is being, it's nothing but just being right with God and being content in troubled time. Oh, we're not content now. Because there's a war raging. There's a war going on. And it's going on in our members. It's going on in your members just like it is in my members. Sometimes I don't know whether I'm going up or I'm going down. If I'm spinning all around. I'm just like someone with the head cut off at times. Don't know which way to go. But then when I come to myself, I know that I serve a God that knows all things and have all power. I fall on my knees and I begin to pray out and call out to him. God, help me to get this straight. Help me to keep my mind stayed on you so that I might be kept in perfect peace. Help me to be suited and booted in the armor of God. That's what he's calling us out of to do. Use the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Get your Bible. Get it off the shelf from underneath the bed. In the back seat of the car, in the trunk of the car, might be outside in the junk house. Blow it out. Open it up and begin to read. Not only read it, but meditate upon it. Meditate in it. Ask for understanding. Ask God to give you clarity on how to apply this word to your life. That's what it means to be putting on the whole armor of God. Read it daily. If you don't read but one verse, read it. Read something daily from the word of God. And then not only just read it, but live it. Practice it. Let others see it in your life. Let it meditate. You know how you kind of, sometimes you roast the chicken in the oven? How you marinate it? How you flavor it up? How you put it on a low temperature so that it can just simmer in the oven and get all of that marinating, them seasonings all through it? Marinate in the word. Use it. Use it. When we tell others about the Bible, the Holy Spirit helps people to see their bad thoughts and actions and make them ask to be forgiven. That's the purpose of it. It's not to put on the shelf and decorate the shelf. I bet I have about 5, 6, 7, 8 bottles in the house. I even have one on my desk in school. I know it looks pretty, but that's not what it's for. establish and equip a maturing church by encouraging them to become and endure hardships. 2 Timothy 2 and verse 3 and 4 says, "Ye therefore must endure hardships as a good soldier of Jesus Christ." No one engages in warfare, entangles themselves with the affairs of this life, that they may please him who enlists him as a soldier. I'm reminded of a time in the history where, and this happened around July the 16th, 1916. How many of you, and some of us, I'm telling my age, but that's okay. It says that there was a sign that was put out, a poster that was put out. There was an ad that was put out, and it was called Uncle Sam putting this out. Remember the gray hair? He had his finger pointed at you, saying, "I want to recruit you for the army of this world." That's what it was. The United States Army. In other words, the military. He was trying to recruit. Satan is still trying to recruit. He got his finger out. He got his tongue out. He got his feet kicked out. He got his eyes rolling around to recruit you. And that's what, and it says that they were recruiting, that during this time that thousands, legions of young men were recruited to fight in World Wars I and II. Satan is recruiting you to fight in World War 2022. That's what he's trying to do. And I'm going to tell you how he's recruiting you. He have our little girls being promiscuous. He having our little boys selling drugs. He have mamas and daddies not speaking nor living the truth. He has the government just gouging your pocketbook. He has all kinds of things going on. We could just say he got it going on, ain't it? You know how we say when we got, "I got it going on." He got it going on. He got it going on. And it's time for us to put on the whole armor of God. It's time for us to put Satan back in his place, into the pits of hell from whence he came. It's time for you and me to be suited and booted by putting on the whole armor of God. And in that time, all that engaged in joining the army of this nation, some of them were shot down. Some did not return home. And some of us are being shot down today. We're being shot down but by the evil devices and schemes of Satan. He's piercing us to our souls with drugs, alcohol, fornication, illicit sex, all kinds of things that keep us from being in the army of God. All kinds of things that keep us from being suited and booted with the whole armor of God. I hope that you are listening to me today. I hope that you understand that there's no fair play with Satan. He don't care how true you are to him. He's not going to be true to you. He's going to steal, kill, and destroy. That's his aim. He was going around as a roaring lion then, and he's still going around as a roaring lion. He's roaring daily, 24/7, as they say, from the time you get up to the time you go to bed, from the rising of the sun to the going down of the same. Satan is waging war.